subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
On popular demand today, this episode of Cut the Clutter on the latest and dramatic turn in Nepal's politics. Now, Nepal's politics is always dramatic. How dramatic? When we last spoke about Nepal, about 7 months back, in December, when Mr. Oli, K.P. Sharma Oli, former Prime Minister, had just dissolved his national parliament. At that point, we had mentioned to you that Nepal has had so much political instability that it has had 49 prime ministers in 58 years. Now, less than a year has passed. So in less than 60 years now, Nepal has completed its half century of prime ministers. So Nepal has its 50th prime minister in Sher Bahadur Deuba. It's besides the point that Sher Bahadur Deuba himself is prime minister for the fifth time. So what has happened? What has happened is that Nepalese Supreme Court came down heavily on K.P. Sharma Oli, reminded him he was growing too big for his boots, also reminded him that no matter how powerful he was, no matter how friendly he was with the president, Vidya Devi Bhandari, he wasn't above the constitution, and constitution was above everybody else. And that is the lesson they gave to President Bhandari also, that she had acted in a partisan manner. Frankly, it is no different. If you read this judgment, it's no different from some of the orders in the past that some of our more infamous governors have got from Indian Supreme Courts or Indian High Courts. So it upbraided the president also and said, your job is to protect the constitution. You cannot make your own decisions beyond the constitution. Constitution limits your powers, and we, as in the Supreme Court of Nepal, we interpret the constitution. So at one level, it's an institutional victory for Nepalese democracy. Fantastic, because Supreme Court, one institution, has stood up and said that they protect the constitution. But politically, what was already a messy situation has now become messier. So I will take off from that episode 645, of which I am sharing a link with you, and please see that, because Nepal also has a very complicated system of elections, which is a combination of first past the post and proportional representation. Remember, proportional representation is something that we keep talking about every time we talk about Israel, but that is straight proportional representation. In Nepal, it's a hybrid. So it's a bit more complicated, and that is what I talk about in detail in 645. So please check that out. I'm not repeating that. Now, what happened in this case was that in December 2020, Oli figured that he was losing majority. Now, how did Oli came to power? That also is a dramatic story. How did Oli came to power this time? But that I will tell you in a moment. So he came to power because the two factions or two communist parties in Nepal united. These were communist parties, one CPN, Communist Party of Nepal, UML, United Marxist Leninist, led by Oli. And second was CPN, Communist Party of Nepal, Maoist Center, led by Prachanda, who himself is a former prime minister and one of the revolutionary leaders of the underground war which the Maoists waged in Nepal for almost a decade and a half. Somewhat dramatically, as the 2018 election was taking place, that was an election supervised once again by Sher Bahadur Deuba in his fourth premiership, in his fourth prime ministership. And I'll give you a listing in just a minute. He was then caretaker. He was holding an election. Just as the election was going on, his former partner, that is Prachanda, split and united with his arch communist rival Oli. It was widely seen as something that was brokered, inspired, whatever you may call it, by the Chinese. So the Chinese got the two communist parties together, and together then they had enough numbers to get Deuba thrown out, and they took power. But in that power arrangement, they decided on a sharing. The sharing was that half the time it was Oli who would have power, and then he will give up and give it over to Prachanda. And as usually happens, by the time December came this year, he had made it amply clear that he had no intention of handing over power to Prachanda, because what had happened meanwhile was that he had packaged himself as this ultra-nationalist taking on India. He had big backing of China. He had changed the map of Nepal, included areas of Lipu Lake, Limpia Dhura, etc. in the map. He also had that map incorporated in the national emblem of Nepal. He even mocked India's national emblem, that is the lion capital, by saying, oh, India's national motto isn't Satyamev Jayate, but Singhmev Jayate, which means whoever is like the lion or whoever is powerful wins, which means might is right. So he had built that ultra-nationalist fervor in Nepal. Of course, much changed dramatically after that, because as he lost power, began to lose power in December, when his attempt at dissolving parliament came unstuck, then he once again came close to India. But that is a different story. We'll talk about that some other time when we talk about India's relations with its neighbors. Now, he dissolved his parliament in December 2020. He did not have the support of any party in parliament, and in fact, many from within his own party also. So they all opposed it. Because he did not want to face a vote of confidence in parliament, he waited, and meanwhile, other people went to court. They went to court and they challenged his decision. So the court in February this year gave an order saying that this dissolution was illegal, and they wanted him to reconvene parliament again and seek a vote of confidence. Now, he knew that he wasn't going to win a vote of confidence. What did he do? He did something that some of our chief ministers do all the time, which is he decided not to call a session of his national parliament. If he's not calling a session of the national parliament, then obviously there'll be no vote of confidence. Meanwhile, how would the laws pass? So he was just passing ordinances. These were the tricks he was using. So once again now, 146 members of National Assembly, which has a strength of 275, effective strength right now of 271. So 146, which is a convenient majority, they went to the Supreme Court challenging him. At which point, he once again, because he was getting desperate on May 21 this year, he once again dissolved the same parliament which the Supreme Court had restored. And when he went to dissolve it, his president went along with him. That's why the president has got such tough strictures from our Supreme Court. And why did the president do it? President said that I am dissolving the house. I agree with the idea of dissolving the house because I don't think anybody will be able to form a stable government in the same house. That is before she had given anybody a chance. On May 21, she said that if anybody claims that he has the numbers to form the government, the leader has to bring the numbers and prove the majority by 5 p.m. tomorrow. By 5 p.m. the next day, Sher Bahadur Juba had landed up with 149 names with her. As that happened, even Oli landed up with 153 names with him. What logic did Oli use? How can one have 153 and 149 in a house of 271? Oli said that I have this commitment. I have letters from leaders of these parties who are going to support me, and their MPs are going to be bound by the whip issued by them. That necessarily doesn't work like that in Nepal. MPs are not necessarily whip bound. So the president figured that he was not going to be able to survive. So in that case, she just dissolved parliament. But there's a trick there that he will continue as caretaker. But the trick is that she did not mention the word caretaker in her order, which looks like a very deliberate omission. And that elections will be held in November and he will supervise that election. When that happened, the Supreme Court got even more active and delivered their order quickly. What that order now does is it restores national parliament. It restores national parliament. It appoints Sher Bahadur Juba, who had then given a list of 149, and they've told him to prove his majority in 30 days. Once again, drama happened when he was appointed, because after the Supreme Court gave this order, the President Bhandari once again issued a notification for his swearing in, but did not say under which provision of the Constitution she was doing that. Because if she was appointing him under Article 75(6) of the Nepalese Constitution, that means that you have to prove your majority within 30 days. She did not say that for some reason, but that then was rectified, and that is the reason why the swearing in was delayed. Now, this has been widely welcomed by democratic forces in Nepal, and I will share a screenshot and also a link with you, an editorial from Kathmandu Post. It's a very forthright and well-written editorial. In fact, see some of the Nepalese media, it is quite good. So that editorial says that what the court has now done is, the court is telling it like it is. That is the headline. And that editorial says that there are many threats to Nepal's democracy, and it's a good thing that now it's been saved from Oli. But then editorial goes on to say, individuals have changed in Singh Darbar. Singh Darbar is like South Bloc, North Bloc, like the Secretariat. Individuals have changed in Singh Darbar, but the specter of high-handed and authoritarian tendency could raise its ugly head again anytime. And then again it goes on to say that leaders come and leaders go, but there are some permanent enemies of democracy. Those permanent enemies are dictatorial leaders with dictatorial, authoritarian and whimsical instincts. All that is directed at Oli in this case. So Oli is out, that's good riddance. This editorial also explains why the court has fired Oli. It says the court has held him guilty of misinterpreting and violating constitutional provisions. It also says, it also rules the fact that Nepal's constitution is only 6 years old, and yet so many attempts have been made to subvert it. But the good thing once again is that at this point, an institution, the institution that looks after the constitution, has spoken up and they've taken the right call by it. Now, I told you some background of how this Prachanda Oli business came into being. In 2018, and elections took place, because before that, in 2017, Duba had come, or Doiba, maybe that's the correct pronunciation. Doiba had come into power by combining with Prachanda's party, that is Maoist Center. Once again, in the remaining term of that parliament, there was a half and half division of prime ministership between Sher Bahadur Doiba and Prachanda. But as it usually happens, as soon as Sher Bahadur Doiba was sworn in 2017, within months, I think he was sworn in June, by October, Prachanda and his party had pulled out, and then all these machinations behind the scenes started, with the Chinese embassy and Chinese government getting very involved in getting both their quote-unquote brotherly communist parties together. So the both parties came together. By this time, Doiba was a lame duck. Elections were held, he resigned in February, and Oli took over power. And I told you what happened later. Oli and Prachanda were to share power, and Oli let Prachanda know where to get off. Meanwhile, he had also changed his map, etc., and ratcheted up this Nepalese ultra-nationalism. At that point, Prachanda thought he got left out. Oli, meanwhile, had gone really close to the Chinese. He was rubbing his finger in the eye of South Bloc all the time. But once he got into trouble in December, he once again started leaning on South Bloc, and it so happens that South Bloc also, it seems to us, somehow took him under their chhatrachhaya. So he became our man in a way. Right now, he's down and out. So once again, India has to do its equation building in Nepalese politics. Before I tell you about the 5 tenures of Mr. Doiba, 4 quite short, let us see how far this one goes. How far this one goes would depend on whether he can win his vote of confidence or not. That also depends on the 2.5 communist party situation. I told you that in the very beginning. 2.5, because Prachanda's party, or Prachanda's faction now, which is Maoist Center, although Supreme Court of Nepal has now dissolved the merger of Maoist Center, CPN Maoist Center, and CPN UML. That party also has 2 factions. So there is a faction led by Madhav Nepal, because Prachanda is now becoming increasingly irrelevant and losing his authority and credibility. So Sher Bahadur Doiba would be hoping that some of those will vote for him. Also, if they don't vote for him, then he will need all 32 members of Janata Samajwadi Party, JSP, to vote for him. JSP is led by Mr. Bhattarai, who you see sometimes interviewed on the print as well. Now I will tell you about the various tenures of Sher Bahadur Doiba as Prime Minister. His first, he started as a student leader, Nepal Students Union leader, NSU, which is a unit of Nepali Congress, a bit like NSUI in India. So he started as a student leader. In 1995, he became Prime Minister the first time, again in instability and a lot of mess. He signed the Mahakali Watershed Treaty with India, which was a very good treaty, which worked well for both countries. He was seen as friendly to India. He fell in March 1997, in exactly 2 years. So his first tenure was 2 years. Second time, after G.P. Koirala resigned, he defeated Sushil Koirala for the leadership of the Nepalese Congress, and he was sworn in 26th of July 2001. just after the royal massacre. You remember the royal massacre when the entire royal family was assassinated by one of the princes. So after the royal massacre, he was sworn in again in 26 July 2001. He announced a ceasefire with the Maoists, but Maoists broke the ceasefire. By October 2002, he was declaring the emergency and doing all kinds of awful things. October 2002, he was dismissed by King Gyanendra as incompetent. So once again, just over a year. At this point, he also got estranged from his own party and set up his own faction, his own party called Nepalese Congress Democratic. Sounds like the Congress in India a little bit. Third time, after two governments fell in Nepal in 2 years, the Darbar himself, the king himself, the same king who had fired Doiba for being incompetent, appointed him prime minister again. So 14 June 2004, he became prime minister again. But soon enough, the king himself, in less than a year, in just about 6 months, the king himself carried out a coup. This was a royal coup where the king dismissed the government, took over all power, transferred every power into his personal authority, put his cabinet, including Doiba, under house arrest. So within a year now, Mr. Doiba was gone again. That was his. So his third term lasted about a year. His fourth term, this is after Sushil Koirala died. He became president of Nepali Congress in 2016. August 2016, as I mentioned to you earlier, he arrived at this rotational arrangement with Prachanda. So he was sworn in on 7th June 2017. Soon enough, 17 October 2017, Maoist Center pulled out, Prachanda's party pulled out. He was a lame duck. He held the election under his supervision, lost power 15 February. So his four terms together do not add up to 5 years. How long this one lasts, we don't know. Nobody gives him that much of a chance because also, first of all, the Nepalese politics is very divided. Second, an election will come at some point soon. The important thing is that even if his government falls now, even if he's not able to win a vote of confidence, he will be the caretaker, or he will be leading the caretaker government that will be holding the next election. That is a big setback for Oli, who would have wanted to do it his own way. So that is gone. So what is the current strength in Nepal's parliament? I will just give you the numbers as of today. So Nepalese Congress has 63, Maoists have 49, Samajwadis have 34, Independents are 2, so this comes to 148. These are the numbers that Doiba put forward to stake his claim, which was accepted. So he has been made prime minister and he has to now win his vote of confidence. On the other side, you have UML, that is Oli's party, with 121, Independents too. So they will be hoping that many of the Maoist center people will break and they will not vote for Doiba, in which case Doiba will not be able to win a majority. But once again, if he does not win a majority, so what? He will still continue to be the caretaker prime minister and he will be holding the next election. Having said all this, I will also tell you that at one point, in out of sheer desperation, Oli had even tried to seek a vote of confidence in his parliament. He only got 93 votes, 124 voted against him. In spite of that, he, in cahoots with the president, continued to stay in power. So that, dear friends, is my least cluttered possible understanding of what has happened in Nepal right now. Anytime you think India's politics is complicated, please check out Nepal's. But remember, our constitution today is 70 years old. Nepal's is only 6 years old. So this is a work in progress. But the important thing is the institutions seem to work there better than they work in some other democracies in our region. So Supreme Court in this case, striking this down, firing the prime minister, upbraiding the president, is actually a good blow struck for institutional democracy.